This is Hester.
And this is Maria.
And this is Silvestro.
And together we are
the Concert Counselors!
Today we bring you a few ideas and exercises inspired by the legendary master Silvestro Ganassi.
Ganassi lived in the first half of the 16th century in Venice, and he played different musical instruments, among them the viol, the cornetto, and the recorder.
He was employed by the Doge of Venice as an instrumentalist. This means that he played together with other musicians in official ceremonies, at receptions, at processions, and probably some of these occasions took place at the majestic Basilica of St. Mark.
Ganassi published two instruction books. The first one in 1535 is La Fontegara, and that is his recorder playing instruction book. Then later on he published two books on playing the viol. Both books are remarkable in that they go way beyond other sources of the time in very specific and advanced aspects of music making.
For instance, La Fontegara includes an extended section on improvised ornamentation using complicated rhythmical proportions. In modern terms, sextuplets, septuplets, quintuplets and more.
And the big question is, did he really use those proportions when he was improvising, or was he rather trying to express in notation a very free way of playing?
Because of these and more questions, Ganassi, his works, and the context he lived in are very, very inspiring at all levels nowadays.
Quite a lot of academics, of artists, of performers, of instrument makers, researchers are actually devoting months, years, maybe their whole careers to study Ganassi.
Just an example, in March 2018 there was a three-day congress in Geneva just about Ganassi and the recorder.
Yes, but today for our episode of Concert Counselors, we want to look at La Fontegara from a very general point of view. So we have selected a couple of things that we find inspiring, and we will give you a few exercises that anyone at any level and playing any repertoire can use.
Would you like to learn more about Ganassi and how this is inspiring for scholars and performers? Check out a few links in the video description below.
In Fontegara, Ganassi explains that the regular range for a recorder in his time, the beginning of the 16th century, was an octave and a sixth.
But later on he adds that after a bit of experimentation, he found seven notes on top of that octave and a sixth. Wow!
Our conclusion is that Ganassi was not afraid of the high register, as many recorder players are nowadays.
Therefore, shall we try the following exercises and get rid of your vertigo?
Take your altos for this exercise.
And we are going to play a chromatic scale up from the high C sharp up to the high C. And we will show you the fingerings as we go.
Divide the group in couples and stand opposite each other.
Look each other straight in the eye and throw your best high notes at each other.
Play the high notes with a winner's mentality, which means that you make sure you stand strong, you make your body ready, you check that the position of the thumb is correct, that you have the right fingering, and then no doubt you play it.
And remember, you don't need to force the high notes. We compare it to arrow and bow shooting. Remember, it's all about a good airstream, the precise position of your fingers, and a clear and precise articulation, and then shoot. Instead of short notes, let's now hold the high notes until the opponent starts. invent different variations on this exercise. For example, replacing the long notes by octaves playing freely.
You can also give yourself even more freedom and just play tiny, really short improvisations and react on each other. But you are only allowed to use tones above the high C sharp.
Couples, you can play one by one or all at the same time, as long as you can judge your own quality of the high pitches.
Ganassi discovered the 7 extra notes in the high register, but actually he doesn't really use them very often in his book. So you may be wondering, why would one practice very high notes that very, very rarely happen in the repertoire?
There are 2 answers to this question. The first one is, the more comfort you have in this really high register, the more control and precision and comfort you have in the regular and standard range of the instrument.
Plus, of course, on the day that you do need those high notes, because you are playing a Telemann concerto or a piece of contemporary music or a very tricky arrangement, you will be glad that you already practiced them and they are not new to you.
In La Fontegara, Ganassi states that we should endeavor to learn from the human voice and try to imitate it. And then later on he says, when the recorder player wishes to imitate the effects of the human voice, he should begin with a moderate flow of breath so that he can increase or decrease it as required.
So, to sum up, Ganassi wants a very dynamic and a very flexible recorder playing, and to do that we certainly need a full control over our breathing system. So that's what we are going to work on now.
To complement the tips and exercises we already gave in episode 17 and other episodes, here comes an exercise that is really, really, really good for your breath control.
And your neighbors will certainly appreciate it after the high notes that we just practiced, because we are going to work with the softest tones that the recorder can produce. Flageolet tones.
Take a middle G and blow very, very, very softly with a stable control over your breath until you reach a very soft sound. Blow a normal G, then decrease your airstream, but keep the power up, and then reach the flageolet tone. Passing on a long flageolet tone on the middle G in couples or in a circle. Or walk forwards or backwards when you play your long flageolet.
Now, very slowly, we keep building up. Alternate with the G fingering, a flageolet tone and a normal tone. And most likely, the pitch is going to be a little bit different, but what is important is to have our most beautiful sound for the normal notes and a very stable and soft flageolet.
invent countless variations on this exercise. For example, now let's start with the normal G and then echo ourselves with the flageolet.
If you start feeling comfortable with the G flageolet tone, then take half a tone lower, go to F sharp. This one is going to be even softer, even more inside than the G. So stay relaxed and look for your F sharp flageolet. We pass it a couple of times, back and forth.
Practice a couple of patterns with G and F sharp imitating each other. And then keep inventing combinations of normal sounds and flageolet tones.
And mix in this with movement and all the things we've been doing. If you feel comfortable with the G and the F sharp and you want to add more flageolet tones, then go on semitone by semitone, and remember, each of them is going to be harder to find and softer. And if you get down to the low, to the middle C or even to the B and get the flageolet out, you're a hero.
These exercises are fantastic to improve your sense of sound production and your breath control. Canassi never wrote about playing flageolets, but I can imagine him doing this.
In the 1970s, several instrument makers went around European museums looking for recorders that may respond to Canassi's fingerings for the high register. One of the makers who was doing this was Fred Morgan, and one of the instruments that he measured has the catalog number SAM135 and is a G alto preserved in the Kunsthistorisches Museum in Vienna.
Morgan produced several versions of this instrument. First, he made a copy which confirmed that most of Canassi's fingerings were working on this particular recorder. Then he modified the construction a little bit to improve the sound and also the tuning.
The result of Morgan's work after all those modifications was a great, excellent instrument with a powerful low register, a wide range and flexible sound, but it's not exactly the type of instrument that Canassi would have actually played on.
To make things even more complicated, recorder players have been performing a solo repertoire of the 17th century on this type of instrument. Music that was written 7200 years after the publication of Canassi's book.
Our 32nd step, therefore, is the article The Canassi Recorder, Separating Fact from Fiction by Adrian Brown, where you can read all the truth and the complete story that we have told you now in 25 seconds.
And our post tip, whether you like to perform early music on instruments that are as close as possible to the originals of these times or not,
being well informed is always a plus.